Can you please introduce yourself?
Yeah, my name is Nadeem Murtuja. I'm head of the Mayor's Office at the London Borough of Newham. I've also been a columnist in a number of newspapers, and you'll have seen from my profile, worked in the public sector for nearly 20 years.
Thank you for coming to the interview.
Thank you.
So the first question this morning is that very recently the UK legislation now requires organisations to report on purpose, employee engagement and culture. How can employers ensure that language diversity, specifically accent diversity, is part of the metrics that are being measured?
Okay, so under the Equality Act 2010, all local authorities and public sector institutions, we had a responsibility, or we have a responsibility, to ensure that we tackle all forms of discrimination, whether that's direct, indirect, or and we are now seeing in organisations issues around institutional discrimination as well, that we foster good community relations, so we ensure that in all our approach we're quite inclusive. But also we think about how we advance equality and fairness within the institutions that we're responsible for. So in that context, not only do public institutions have responsibilities in terms of ensuring that all people with protected characteristics, they're able to play a full role in terms of their careers, but they're also able to actually progress. And anything which contributes to their potential discrimination in the workplace, etc., is not only, you know, so it's not only do we actually have the evidence and the intelligence of how that's formed, but we're able to actually tackle that, and thereby ensuring that our policy framework that we put together ensures we're able to actually address those factors in terms of ensuring that we have an environment where all employees can actually fulfill their aspirations and purpose.
Thank you very much for that. Clearly, the board of directors have a key role to play in demonstrating the significance of an organization's values and behavior. How can they ensure that accent inclusion is embedded, modeled, and monitored across the workforce?
And that's a really important question. So we have quite strong and robust employment monitoring frameworks. So we're able to, for example, check and challenge where people of particular characteristics are not actually at particular tiers of the organisation. So where we have issues around underrepresentation, we're able to check when particular people are disproportionately having to go through disciplinary action. And that kind of evidence is really important alongside monitoring our workforce profile, because what it actually tells us is a number of factors. It tells us how inclusive we are. It tells us about issues around unconscious bias. It tells us about the lack of, if you like, inclusion and diversity within the decision-making process. So the lack of inclusion within the institution itself. And that's where the board of directors actually play a really fundamental role. Because when we talk about diversity and inclusion, we have to think about diversity and inclusion in two factors. Mm-hmm. Diversity, you know, I sometimes think is a bit of a numbers game, because we're tackling underrepresentation and we want to actually have a workforce that reflects the people that we serve. But from an inclusion, it's how we use that evidence and that intelligence to make inclusive decisions. So that's mm-hmm. where the directors come in. And it's up to them to actually set the context, the vision for an organization, and then making sure how that then translates through an institution right to a front line. And it's in that context, an organisation that then actually becomes more inclusive. But there's a broader point to this. This isn't just about ensuring that we actually have an environment. There's actually real economic benefits. Mm-hmm. So if you read, for example, McKinsey report, it identifies that those organisations across the world which have actually really embraced diversity, really become more inclusive in terms of the decision making, they actually have much higher productivity, they actually have much greater economic benefits, and so on and so forth. So ultimately, this is a real win-win situation. And that's why the board of directors shouldn't actually see this as something they must do. They must actually see this actually, it contributes to their sustainability, it will contribute to productivity, it will contribute to actually quality and environment, and it will also actually contribute to actually having a real place, particularly in this world of globalization, where diversities are intersecting.
Very rich insights there. Thank you very much. I mean, obviously, accents share a lot of commonalities with the other protected characteristics, whether it be age, gender, you name it. Yeah. And most importantly, accent, you know, cuts across all of these other protected characteristics. Yeah. So what are your thoughts on accents becoming a protected characteristics? Is it achievable? If so, what would be the best way of actually achieving this?
Okay, I think there's, I mean, when you say it cuts across, I'd prefer to use the word intersectionality.
Yeah.
Because it intersects. And I think we know, for example, race, age, disability, etc., gender, you know, all of these factors intersect with accents. And I think what's really important is that if we're going to actually really ensure that it's actually reflected in the way we actually do business within institutions, we need to make sure that we're better in capturing evidence, capturing intelligence, understanding the kind of understanding our workforce profile better, understanding diversity in its most broadest sense, but also ensuring that within the policy framework, which is ultimately the governance of an organization, that clearly reflects how we're going to embrace various accents and diversity experiences, but also actually have making sure we actually have the right safeguards in place to ensure that people aren't excluded and even potentially at the worst, most extreme and discriminated. And if we have a policy framework which is enabled to do that at an institutional level, then what we have is an environment for all employees, including partners or people who actually connect with institutions, to actually have healthy relationships. In terms of, you know, how do we actually embed this, I think there is something about policy research, academia, to bring this kind of evidence base together in terms of really unpicking why, for example, we have issues in the criminal justice system, in the education system, in the health system, etc., in terms of why Black ethnic minorities haven't actually fared as well as their white counterparts. And that's where the point of intersectionality comes in. Yeah. So, for example, you can be an hijab-wearing Black woman with an accent, and ultimately it's not just somebody's, if you like, it's not just the hijab, it's not just the ethnicity, it's not just the accent, it's the intersect between all of those kind of factors that need to be modelled together in terms of understanding what the overall characteristics are, because ultimately no human being is a single dimension, we're multidimensional. And in that regard, I think there's a real role to play in terms of academia, research, evidence, to actually feed into that policy development, to then actually feed into how that actually then translates into organisations. And I think if organisations then see it from a perspective of, well, actually, that's why we have issues of unconscious bias in the recruitment process. That's why we have actually issues of disproportionality in terms of disciplinary. That's why we actually have issues in terms of outcomes. Then it starts making a difference. So I think the first step is to actually get, you know, some of it, most of it already exists. I don't think any of this is rocket science. But I think getting the Equality and Human Rights Commission in the UK to commit to basically put really good, strong case studies which run almost in parallel with legislation and policy, So employers, even those monocultural institutions, actually have the real case studies to actually use and utilise to actually understand, because you're quite right to point out, this isn't just about black ethnic minority, this is about regional accents. And even from a regional accent, or from, the UK is made up of, you know, four countries. And even from that perspective, this is really important.
Thank you very much for that. That brings us to the end of the interview. Thank you very